Next, we'll be presenting, just flying in from Puerto Rico, Dr. Michael Johansson, a biologist with CDC's Dengue Branch in San Juan, who completed his PhD with Johns Hopkins. And today he's talking to us about bringing the public into public health. Dr. Johansson.
So I'm going to talk about public health today, particularly about the public part of public health. I got started in public health a number of years back, getting my feet wet both literally and figuratively in Iquitos, Peru, right here. It's a city right on the Amazon River. I went there to investigate leptospirosis. Leptospirosis is a bacterial disease that's present in a lot of, the bacteria is present in a lot of different animals. They pass it through their urine and it can contaminate different water sources, and if people come in contact with that water, they can become infected. Now, Iquitos is a place where there's a lot of water, a lot of people living in close contact with the water, and a lot of animals, so we knew that it might be a problem there. Leptospirosis is difficult because it can cause really severe disease in people, but it's also easily treatable via penicillin or any sort of basic antibiotic like that, well, certain ones. However, you often don't recognize the disease until it's in the later stages when it's difficult to treat. So knowing whether or not this is a problem in a certain community can be very helpful in terms of treating these cases that are more severe. So we knew that there'd been a few cases there. We knew that they had the right risk factors. We didn't know how much disease was present. So we went there to investigate it. First thing we found when we went into this community was people. The people, we went, visited their houses, talked to the people, told them about leptospirosis, looked at the way they were living, risk factors that were present or not present there, and took blood samples when they were willing to participate in our study so that we could test them and see if they'd been exposed. It turns out that they had been exposed. Over a quarter of the people had evidence of previous exposure to leptospirosis. Having been working in this community, we knew what the houses were like and we knew some of the risk factors that might be there. So we went back to the houses and started trapping rats because we found that there were rats pretty much everywhere in this community. So we took a bunch of rats out of there, took the rats back to the lab, tested the rats. A bunch of the rats came up positive. About 10% of them were actively infected with Leptospira, the bacteria. So this was a small success story of public health, that we were engaging the community by going and visiting the people and trying to understand the situation they were living in, and by talking to them and doing our testing that we could find out that they were having this problem there, and we also found the source of the problem, which was the rats. So this is a story of community engagement leading to public health success. And there's a lot of different ways that community engagement can lead to public health success. One of them is this, and it's probably the first thing that I learned and the most important thing that I learned in Peru. And it's that public health problems are really not the problem of a bacteria or the problem of a virus or the problem of certain people or a certain place. Rather, the problems that are created by an ecosystem that includes all these things and other factors. Here's another picture of Iquitos, this part of Iquitos. Here we have boats, we have the water, we have the houses that are closely packed together. There's a lot of trash up there that you can't really see very well in this picture. These are all things that are based in the tradition and the history of this community. They make it a unique and special place, but they also make it a really good place for leptospirosis. You wouldn't really know that unless you go there. So getting engaged with the community helps you understand these problems and start to get a better grasp on them. Community engagement is also really important for public health success on the intervention side. You know, going there and saying that, oh, we have a big problem here is just the first step. We're doing that because we want to be able to do something about it and improve people's health. You can't really do that unless you also engage the community. So whether your intervention is a vaccine, telling people to wear boots when they're working in the water in a community like this, or telling people to use bed nets to prevent malaria transmission, you need to engage the community. Whatever intervention that you have is not going to work unless people are actually using it. So we met with some success in Peru. I mean, this is a fairly small scale thing. Lots of people have done things like that. We tried to think about ways that we could make a bigger impact on the public in involving the public in public health. So let's say for a minute now that I'm not worried about the people in Iquitos. I'm worried about the people here. Now, if I'm worried about your health, the traditional thing that we do in epidemiological disease surveillance is that we assume that sort of the doctor knows best, right? So we go and ask doctors about people, and we have the doctors report on their patients who are sick, and then they have certain diseases that are reportable, and we get them in the surveillance system, and we find out what diseases are maybe going around in the community. Well, this is a perfectly reasonable way to do it, and it works quite well. But there's another way we could do it. Instead of asking the doctors if people are sick, we could ask people if people are sick. So we call this participatory surveillance. If I wanted to do this right now, I could go around and ask everyone in this room if they were sick. It might take me a little while, but I could probably get some decent data out of you guys if someone has had illness in the last week or 2 weeks. Another way that I could do it is just ask you to raise your hand if you've had a fever in the last month. That would make it go faster. You know, I could just count it up. There'd be some maybe reliability issues. Maybe my counting's not that good. Maybe you don't want to admit that you had a fever yesterday. There's another way that I could do this, though, that I could get input from all of you anonymously, pretty much simultaneously, and then share that data with you. We could do that if we did it all digitally. So there's different ways that you can do this, but the way that I'm going to talk about now is called internet-based participatory surveillance. So in this case, we're just using the internet to collect data from people about whether they're sick or not, and it can be entered anonymously and then shared broadly immediately. This is the system that we use in Puerto Rico. It's called Salud Boricua. People get an email every week. You sign up for the system, then people who are participating get an email every week. I know most of you probably can't read this. This is just a list of symptoms. So the person goes into the website every week, clicks on any symptoms that they had, or they click that they didn't have any symptoms that week. This takes 10 or 15 seconds after you've done it the first time or two, and that's it. That's all you have to do to participate in this system. This system grew out of another system called Flu Near You that some of you may have heard of. That's present in the United States looking at influenza. Immediately after answering this, which only takes that 10 to 15 seconds, you get to look at this map. And this is a map of Puerto Rico, and it shows where people are reporting illness. So these red dots there are places where at least one person in a zip code is reporting having symptoms of dengue. So we know that there's some problems in those areas. Now, this is kind of a nifty public health tool, right? But can it really like have an influence on a larger scale? Let's think about what we really try to get out of surveillance data. One of the most important things is that we want to capture disease. So in a traditional surveillance system, we capture disease by capturing clinical cases of disease, people who go and seek medical care. And then the doctor, if they diagnose a case of a certain kind of syndrome, they might report that to a system and to the surveillance system, and you get reporting going up the chain. Eventually, reports get aggregated and a report comes out. In a participatory surveillance system, you can actually capture even more disease because you can capture people who get sick and maybe don't go to the doctor. Maybe I have a sore throat and a fever for a few days, but I have so many things to do at work that I try to work from home instead of get people sick at work, but I don't go to the doctor because I don't want to sit in a waiting room for 10 hours when I could be doing something else or resting and trying to get better. Another thing that we look for in a surveillance system is that it's timely, right? We're trying to collect data on diseases because we want to do something about it. It doesn't really help that much if we know something happened 3 or 4 months ago. We'd really like to know what's happening now. In the participatory surveillance system, this data is immediate. So as soon as the data is entered, it's there and people can see it. Not just the public health authorities, but anyone, the public can see it, so they can start reacting if there's disease in their community. We also would like a system that's inexpensive. Now, creating these systems isn't that easy. You know, we're still in the early stages of it. But basically, once you have it, you need to maintain your servers and you need to have some developers on hand. But it's pretty easy to run compared to a traditional system where you have different levels of reporting and involvement with clinicians, laboratory testing, et cetera. You also want a system that's scalable. So with a system like this, we can easily go from 1,000 people to 10,000 people. You just need more server capacity, basically. But you also need people with internet access, which is not true everywhere, but it's also increasing globally. This is in fact, Salud Boricua is a good example of this, because we didn't have a system in Puerto Rico, and we didn't have the money, the resources to put together a system. So luckily, we found our partners at Boston Children's Hospital and the Health Map Group who had developed this Flu Near You, which is a very similar system. And so we just worked with them to modify their system so that it would suit our needs in Puerto Rico. So very easily, we came up with a system. So we have this whole new system that we created, basically with a little bit of collaboration, and that was it. Lastly, to get back to this point, we want to engage the public. So this is a way that we can very easily get people involved with public health. People can come in and they can report and they can also see the data in real time. The maps are interactive. You know, there's some different features in there. We also provide information on the diseases, ways to prevent the diseases, and some information about vaccination. Salud Boricua and Flu Near You aren't the first systems. They're some of the more recent ones. The first systems came out in 2003 in Europe, and it's been expanding. There's a few new systems each year. it's nice to have all these systems out there because we've started to accumulate some data that can show that these systems can actually work. So here's one example of one of these systems. This is from the Netherlands in 2007. And these are influenza-like illness curves. So these are people who are reporting influenza-like illness. One of these curves is from a traditional surveillance system where people go to the doctor and it's reported. It's called a sentinel surveillance system, and the doctors report it in the cases. The other is a participatory surveillance system. You can see that they both perform pretty well and pretty similarly. So one of them, they're both capturing the increase in incidence at about the same time, and they're capturing the peak of incidence at the same time. Now, they look very similar, but remember that one of these systems is a heck of a lot cheaper, and it also is getting you the data a week or 2 weeks faster. That's the participatory surveillance system. So you're getting some of the same data, but you're getting it faster and at less expense. Now, there's another thing that's different between these two things, and now I've put up the axis here. So you can see these are actually estimates of the incidence rates in the overall population. So they're estimates in numbers of cases per 100,000 people. And you can see that the participatory surveillance system is actually much more sensitive. So they're capturing a lot more disease. And this is true of the other systems as well in the other countries. It's not always 10 times as much as what we're seeing here. Sometimes it's a little more, sometimes it's a little less. But basically, you're capturing a lot of these people who are sick but don't go to the doctor, or they go to the doctor and the doctor thinks it's some other disease, maybe doesn't report that it's influenza. So there's a lot to be gained potentially here in sensitivity as well of what the true burden of disease is. Here's another example. This is from the Flu Near You website. So on there, there's a question about vaccination in the weekly survey. So we ask if people have had a flu vaccine since the last time that they reported. There's also this tool that helps people find places where they can get vaccinated. So you enter your zip code and it spits out the closest vaccination centers. Now, what's interesting about this in particular is that this summer they did a survey of their users. And out of all the people who got flu vaccines and responded to this survey last year, so this is the 2012-2013 season, 5% of those people said that they got the vaccine because of Flu Near You. Now, this is kind of remarkable. 5% is not a huge number, but think about what it really means. These people are participating online in a surveillance system, and it's actually influencing what they're doing in their daily life, and that they're taking a public health action that's very positive just due to their participation in here. And then, so there's even a perceived benefit and a real benefit because these people are getting vaccinated. So these systems are still sort of in their infancy, even though some of them have been around for 10 years. There's a whole lot of room for expansion, both geographically and getting more participants. There's rooms for improving the quality and the quantity of the data. There's a lot that could be done here, and I think we're just seeing the beginning. So to improve public health, we can really engage the public. We can ask people if they're sick. We can do it digitally. And we can bring the public into public health in a really meaningful way. Thanks.
I think you have to give the other mic back. Thank you for that. Tell me how the traditional public health surveillance community reacts to information like this that shows that a private sector voluntary system emulates public health data pretty closely. Does that represent a threat or an opportunity?
I think clearly an opportunity. I mean, I'm from the traditional side, right? I work here. So it's clearly an opportunity, and it's not part of what I presented are the benefits of it. There's certainly benefits of the traditional system as well. For example, that there's a lot of systems that include laboratory testing, which participatory surveillance doesn't deal with yet. So it's really based on symptoms rather than clear diagnostics that you get out of a lab. So I think that it's really a question of how the two systems complement each other. And I think most people do see that.
Very good. Thank you again.